Kazukian Network presents Riffin' on Jazz with your host, Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey.
Sonny Rollins.
You got to improve, man. You got Coltrane and Ornette Coleman and these boys coming up. You better get your stuff together.
Mr. Miles Davis.
White people are funny. They, in America, they thought that I just woke up one morning and had the blues and started playing the trumpet. But it don't go like that, and you can't explain that to them.
Miles was able to make something that was wrong into something that was right.
Now they know. I'm not an accident.
Riffin' on Jazz.
Riffin' on Jazz. On Jazz. On
Jazz. Hello and welcome to Riffin' on Jazz. Riffin' on Jazz is your weekly visit with friends talking about the music that we love.
That classic African-American art form called jazz.
I am Howard Robertson.
And I'm Malvin Massey from WUMR.
That's right. That's
I never say that.
Where you been for how many years now?
It's been 30 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, well, it'd be 30 years next year because I went there in 1988.
Yeah. You got the voice, man. I only dream that I could speak like that.
You know what I was telling Larry, that I don't even use my radio voice when I'm here with you on the radio.
Hey, man. Hey. Well, I mean, it is your radio voice.
No.
That's the natural thing. But thematically, okay. We got a fantastic show today. It is called The Kings of Keys, of the Keys, Kings of the Keys, Part 1. Now, we're going to talk about piano players.
Yeah. And the idea being that there are so many of them, and there are so many of them that are so good. It's impossible to get them all in every
Absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely. And let us do this disclaimer right now, okay? We're not saying anybody is the best. We are simply saying that there are some tremendous dynamic, a multitude of excellent piano players, and we're going to talk about some.
Yeah, and the ones that the whole idea originally was that we were going to talk about the chronologically go down the most influential and this and that, and then we finally figured out, hey, let's just talk about our favorites.
Just talk about
as well as that.
Our favorites, too. And when you look at something, I mean, on the internet, the you can get the greatest of all time list of everything, but the top three on this particular list that we're looking at included Art Tatum, Oscar Peterson, and the person that inspired both of them was number three, and his name is Fats Waller.
Yeah.
I love Fats Waller. I love Fats Waller. Fats Waller, the music is happy music and whatnot, and a lot of people looked at him as a novelty kind of act. Because he did Ain't Misbehaving and it had some funny songs and whatnot.
He had comedy, comedic songs, and whatnot.
But he was one hell of a piano player.
And composer.
Yeah. And he did stride piano. And if you're wondering what stride piano is, listen to this.
Yes, sir, when she turns on that southern personality to set you right, she's dynamite. Three words describe her charms galore. Just three words, I don't mean four. She's tall, tan, terrific. Mm-hmm. Streamlined on a belt from Tennessee. Thank you. describe the charm of the law. Three words, I don't need four. Tall, tan, perfect gasser, streamlined Luna Bell from Tennessee.
Stride piano. Thank you, Fats Waller.
You know, so we're talking about the history of it and everything. So stride piano, like we were just saying, was the first step from ragtime. Scott right. Joplin's ragtime mm-hmm. was sort of leaning toward jazz, getting us away from John Philip Sousa. And then there comes that stride piano, and that's right. was the man, Fats Waller.
And stride, what makes stride piano is the left hand. And in the rest of this show, even in the interviews that we've got coming up, you're going to hear that all jazz pianists are not created equal. It has everything to do with that left hand. Now, with the stride, it's up and down. I mean, if you watch somebody playing stride piano,
that came from
Scott Joplin.
Yeah, from that ragtime.
Absolutely. Jumping up and absolutely. He was a big, big influence, and he was a particularly big influence on cats like Art Tatum. Art Tatum was an interesting guy. I think he was born in Toledo, if I'm not mistaken. And he was, as we call it now, legally blind. He was almost totally blind in one eye due to cataracts, yeah. And had only limited vision in his other eye. But I understand that he was a prodigy. And he had perfect pitch. And it's funny because they said they had to get the piano in his house. He started playing at a very, very young age, like five or something. And they said they had to get the piano tuned constantly because he had perfect pitch. And it would drive him crazy hearing a note or out of key, out of tune. On the piano, so he cost his folks a lot of money having to do that. But Art Tatum was a big, big influence. On everybody else, and Fats Waller was a big influence
on him. Yeah, as everybody was coming down along the way there.
Right,
these were the guys, and we're gonna mention as we're talking about this. So then we're gonna talk about Phineas or Phineas Newborn Jr. We're gonna talk about him as we come along, but. And then there's so many other cats, you know, that influenced people that we don't know about. James Williams was a major influence, and that was a contemporary. Yeah,
right,
James was our age.
Right.
James was born in 1951.
Right.
Eastern Star Church was his daddy's church.
Baptist Church.
That's where he learned how to play the piano.
Right.
So, you know, that's another one to mention. Charles Thomas from Over Across the Bridge. Mm-hmm. That was another cat. Mm-hmm. He played with Duke Ellington. Mm-hmm. And then he quit because mm-hmm. he didn't like playing for Duke.
Mm-hmm.
There are so many influential piano players like that.
So
we can't get into all of that. But I did want to make sure that we mentioned that so many of these guys are from Memphis, Tennessee.
Absolutely. And were influential to cats all over the world. I wanted to mention Oscar Peterson. Oscar Peterson, yeah, Canadian born, and he was a prodigy as well. But Oscar Peterson played such lush piano chords, and again that left hand.
Speedy Gonzalez. Yeah.
He could do anything on his left hand that he could do on his right hand, and he did them together. And Phineas was like that,
just
too.
Like it. Yeah,
absolutely.
Played like he
absolutely.
Had three hands. But we're gonna talk totally. About we're gonna do Errol Garner,
my man.
Yeah,
my man. Talk to you while he was playing.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Garner. A lot of people don't know that that song you just heard, Misty, a classic he wrote.
And it's one of the most covered songs ever. In the history of jazz. And yo, then the cool
somebody
thing
in
about
his
it,
family still getting those royalties.
The cool thing about it that he never learned how to play. He was self-taught playing the piano.
Totally.
He played by ear all his life.
Started when he was 3 years old, right?
Yeah.
And what were you saying about the lady that taught his siblings?
Yeah, what was it? It was in Pittsburgh, Miss Bowman.
Okay.
Yeah, he started playing. His elder siblings were taught piano by Miss Bowman. In the early age, Earl would sit down and play anything she had demonstrated, just like Miss Bowman.
He didn't take the piano lessons formally. He just watched Miss Bowman.
Yeah.
That was his lesson.
That was one of the coolest guys, though, on the piano. The way he played, all kinds of styles.
Yeah.
But he was one of the first bebop piano players.
Yeah.
Along with Diz and those guys.
He was smooth, too. Had a good looking, big, full mustache and
pompadour.
Hair was fried, dyed, and laid to the side, baby.
Groove Holmes talked about doing gigs. When they get through gigging out in Los Angeles, they all go to this club, and Errol Garner, where he played, and everybody come in there after 2 o'clock and jam.
Totally.
It's more Riffin' on Jazz coming up.
Riffin' on Jazz. R&R on sports. Artivism. Best in blue. Funky politics. Blues in the basement. Neighborhood Connect. Riffin' on Jazz. On the Kudzukian Network.
I'll play the blues for you.
Blues in the Basement with Stephanie and T. Shaw.
Some great festivals going on around the tri-state area.
Got your dancing shoes?
Man, as long as I'm with you, baby, I'm always be on my toes.
Drop that zero.
Bring your blues, boo.
I got him.
We'll see you.
Thank you.
Blues in the Basement.
The thrill is gone.
Blues in the Basement, part of the Kudzukian Network.
The thrill is gone away.
We're riffing on jazz.
This next gentleman that we're going to hear from, who was a pioneer in so many ways. He was a pioneer of cool jazz.
Yeah.
When you say cool jazz, when you feel cool jazz, you have absolutely got to consider and listen to Dave Brubeck.
Yeah. He sort of set the standard back in the 50s.
Right.
When everybody, Perry Mason and Peter Gunn and all those shows, when they walk into a club, you heard jazz going and you saw a cat at the piano
like
look like Dave Brubeck.
Right. That's very, very cool. And he was also a leader in terms of civil rights, civil and human rights. He had an integrated band. And
one of the first ones to do that after the war.
Totally. And that caused him quite a bit of consternation and problems in the public with playing certain gigs at certain places. He talks about it.
He had to turn down a couple of gigs in the 50s and 60s because they wouldn't accept his bass player, who was first cat in there. And then after that, He even turned down a TV show because right. they weren't going to show him.
And he talks about it.
When we landed in Texas, we all went to the dining room to eat, and they wouldn't serve the black guys. The guys had to go around and stand at the kitchen door. This one guy, he said he wouldn't eat any of their food, and he started to cry. And he said, what I've been through, and the first day I'm back in the United States, I can't even eat with you guys. He said, I wonder why I went through all this. You know, the first black man that I saw, my dad took me to see on the Sacramento River in California. And he said to his friend, open your shirt for Dave. There. There was a brand on his chest. And my dad said, these things can't happen. That's why I fought for what I fought for.
All right, Dave Brubeck.
Yeah. He was a righteous guy, man.
Totally. You know? Totally. And a very well-trained pianist.
Yeah.
That, you know, that whole, whenever you pioneer a whole genre of music, I think you have to have some very, very special skills and whatnot, because that says to me that you are doing something unlike anything anybody has done before.
Yeah.
And that whole cool jazz thing, that was, I mean, you know, people came after him, obviously, but, you know, it was a very, very special thing. And what he did with Take Five back in the day was unheard of. Take Five sold more records than any jazz, quote unquote, jazz record it ever had.
Yeah. Before. And that style he set, that style that he set in the late 50s, all the way down through the 60s. This was the cool style. This was, cool. like I said, the TV, you are advertising, man. Right. You know, the marketing was all about cool.
Right.
And he was the
and
leader of all
everybody was
that.
Doing it. Bands yeah. were doing. I had a band part for Take Five, alto sax. Bands were doing that yeah. that music, and that was unheard of back then.
Yeah.
But as an example of his artistry, this next song coming up, Strange Metal Art.
Yeah, and this is him on the keyboard for
totally.
Real. Yeah. Thank you.
Griffin on Jazz. On Jazz. On
Jazz. On Jazz. Phineas Newborn.
Riffin on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network. We are riffing on jazz on the Kazookian Network.
Rolling down the street with my radio on, listening to Funky Politics.
The mayor of the city of Memphis, Mayor Jim Strickland. How are you, sir?
Fantastic.
We keep it real, we keep it right, and we keep it funky.
Funky Politics, part of the Kazookian Network.
I'll play the blues for you.
Blues in the Basement with Stephanie and T. Shaw.
Some great festivals going on around the tri-state area.
Got your dancing shoes?
Man, as long as I'm with you, baby, I'm always me on my toes.
Drop that zero.
Bring your blues, boo.
I got them.
We'll see you.
Thank you.
Blues in the Basement.
The thrill is gone.
Blues in the Basement, part of the Kazookian Network.
The thrill is gone away.
R&R on sports. Artivism. Best in blue. Funky politics. Blues in the Basement. Neighborhood Connect. Riffin' on jazz. On the Kazookian Network.
Riffin' on jazz.
Kazookians riffin' on jazz.
Well, you know, ladies and gentlemen, Phineas Newborn, not only is he one of our greatest jazz stylists on the piano, but he is also a man who has contributed a lot to the evolution of great jazz piano. In fact, his style of playing the same thing with both hands at the same time, and of course he's the only one that can really do it because he has many imitators, including some of our big people, to imitate you with that. Phineas, how did you come across that idea of doing the thing in octaves there with each hand simultaneously at the same time, you know?
Oh, Oscar Denard and I played that way for years, mm-hmm. you know. And, well, Hanan books I used to study, you know, for classical Hanan exercises for mm-hmm. piano dexterity, for yeah. finger dexterity and everything, articulation and all that bit.
Yeah.
I used to study that book, you know, but mm-hmm. I got tired of playing everything in C.
Phineas Newborn. Look, I gotta tell you this. Phineas Newborn story. Favorite Phineas Newborn story. My dad used to have a barbecue restaurant on the corner of Crumpin, Mississippi, in the area,
in the neighborhood,
in the
yeah.
neighborhood where he lived.
Yeah.
And one day, so I was in there. We were in there one day, and there was this little guy sitting over in one of the booths with an overcoat on, staring very lustfully at one of his waitresses, one of his employees, and staring down into a cup of coffee. My dad said, come here, let me tell you something. I said, see that dude over there? I said, the dude in the overcoat with his face in the cup of coffee? He said, yeah. And then he went straight Richard Pryor. Dude's a genius. Been all over the world. Been on the Ed Sullivan Show. Done everything, been everywhere, and now look at him. And then he said, and then the key was, he said, a woman got him like that. And that was my introduction to Phineas Newborn.
Wow. Yeah, I really got to know him when I came back from the Air Force and started playing with the Pug, Eddie Pug,
right.
Dan,
right.
playing with Pug. And
right.
He was his brother Calvin played with us and everything, but everybody knew Phineas and everybody knew about how he played and the way that he played. Some people said, like you said, your dad said he played like he had four hands, you know.
Right.
And everybody said, yeah, his left hand was so fast and so good. But when he wanted to slow things down, he could do that too. He had a lot of soul in mm-hmm, what he played.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as piano was concerned, he defined bebop in a whole nother time, in a whole nother area of the world than New York, where the bebop guys were Diz and Charlie Parker and all those guys. He defined bebop piano here in Memphis, Tennessee.
Absolutely. But, and he took it, I think one of his first gigs was in Stockholm.
Oh, yeah. He loved Europe. He traveled with Fred Ford.
Okay.
Remember Fred
right.
Ford? Saxophone player.
Absolutely.
He and Fred Ford used to play together a lot, and they traveled to Europe together.
Wow.
And there's a story. I'm not going to tell that story on this thing about what happened that made Phineas so mean when he got back. But mm-hmm. it made him mean. But he and Fred Ford, they traveled all over Europe playing every place in Amsterdam, in London, in Paris, every place it was to play, and they treated him like kings over there.
And he could play anything, as evidenced by this next song. We're riffing on jazz. Now, I might add that on this list of greatest jazz pianists, Phineas is number 12. And two steps down, and I won't say down, but away, number 14 is a cat named George Shearing that you know a little something, something about.
Well, I'm always, for one thing, he's one of the best sounds on a piano. And when we talked about Brubeck creating that cool sound, there was another cool sound in the 50s and 60s that went along with it. And that was the vibraphone with the piano.
Wow.
And that was George Shearing.
Wow.
He created that.
That was a very, very nice sound. That was a sexy sound.
Yeah.
That was very cool sound. Yeah.
In 49,
you hear that, you want to smoke a cigarette.
In 1949, he formed this quintet with Margie Hyams on vibraphone. And it was a new innovation. They weren't, you know, we had Bags was playing the vibes,
right.
Hamp was playing the vibes
right.
and stuff, but nobody was doing it like this. Every track
keyboard
that they did,
and
the keyboard and the vibes, they were playing the same lines.
Yeah. Yes.
And you could hear it and you couldn't hear it. And it was it was an elegance in that sound.
Right.
And I think that one of the things about George Shearing that I love, he gave elegance to his sound.
Right. Mm. And I mean, that's a perfect word. That is a perfect word, elegance, because that's what it did. I mean, you know, you feel that, and as you said, nobody had done it.
I mean,
to my knowledge, nobody had done it before in terms of playing together.
That was him.
Yeah. He playing the same lines, But that's phenomenal. And you know, influences. Now, I don't know who influenced him.
Well, he was a Brit, you know, and he came over. He played in the pubs for a few pennies a time, you know, and this and that. But he was blind from birth, too.
Yeah. That another great blind piano player.
Yeah. That Shearing Sound CD, they did the front of it. They had dogs. Okay. And each one, all the dogs got on shades.
Shades. That's fantastic. Yeah. That is fantastic. But you're talking about Brits. Brits were deeply, always deeply, deeply influenced by Americans and American musicians.
Yeah.
I mean, heck, all the way up. You look at the Beatles. Look at the Stones. They were influenced by blues players.
Bo Diddley.
Absolutely.
Guys,
totally. But while we're talking about Georges, there's another one. One of my favorite Georges. That's not on this list, by the way, but I don't care. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me. This guy's name was George Duke. George Duke. Fantastic pianist. And keyboardist. And fusion, I mean, just gave fusion a whole
new definition.
Identity and definition.
Because we started it off as fusion, and then it became smooth jazz,
Right.
And George Duke was in the middle of all of that. And he played with Cannonball.
Right.
He played with another big guy.
Right.
And he was another one of those guys that was a foundation. The guys that played with George Duke ended up in their own bands or making their own hit records and stuff.
And the thing I loved about George Duke is he could go from straight ahead jazz to classical to the Greater Triple Rock Missionary Baptist Church. It didn't matter. It did not matter. All styles, all genres. And a very, very interesting thing. I know that there are some Zappa fans out there. Was that who?
Frank Zappa.
Yeah. He played with Zappa.
Played with Zappa for a while.
And a lot of people don't know, he might have played a few keyboards with Zappa, but what he played mostly with Zappa was trombone.
And now that's another thing. This cat was a multi-instrumentalist.
Totally.
Played everything. Who knew he played trombone?
Totally. And so we're going to get out of here, man. We got to get out again.
Man, what was Larry talking about? We take too long or something.
This goes fast. This goes fast. But thank you for being with us again on Riffin' on Jazz here on the Kazugian Network. And be back with us next week. And we're going to take you out with a couple of Georges.
All right.
Good to be with you, bro.
You too,
Doc. All right. Thank you.
on Jazz.
Thank you. Riffin on Jazz. Executive produced by Kitsukian. Co-host by Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey Jr. Music curation by Howard and Malvin. And recorded at Kitsukian Studios.
Riffin on Jazz on the Kitsukian Network.